Hello, welcome to our EE seminar. My name is Linda Bushnell, and I'm really happy to introduce Yasser Shoukry. He's a postdoc scholar at the EECS department at UC Berkeley, the EE department at UCLA, and the ESC department at the University of Pennsylvania. He received his electrical engineering degree from UCLA in 2015, where he was affiliated with both the Cyberphysical Systems Lab as well as the Network and Embedded Systems Lab. Before joining UCLA, he spent 4 years as an R&D engineer in the industry of automotive embedded systems. His research interests include the design and implementation of secure and privacy-aware cyber-physical systems and Internet of Things by drawing on tools from control theory, optimization theory, embedded systems, and formal methods. Yasser is the recipient of the Best Paper Award from the International Conference on Cyber-Physical Systems in 2016. He's also the recipient of the UCLA EE Distinguished PhD Dissertation Award in 2016 and the UCLA Chancellor Prize in 2011 and 2012. So welcome, Yasser.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Linda, for the introduction, and thank you for hosting me today and giving me this opportunity to share with you some of my research. So today I will talk about how we can build secure cyber-physical systems. I will focus mainly on one new technique that we have been developing that we call Satisfiability Modulo Convex Optimization. Before going to the details, let's ask the question, what are cyber-physical systems actually are? And a good way to answer this question is by giving some examples. So in the first example here, we show a fully autonomous container terminal at Germany. You see here, everything is completely autonomous. There is no human interaction at all. Everything runs by its own. All these cars are driving by themselves. All the information collected from hundreds and thousands of sensors using computation and communication technology goes to a central computer that starts to control everything inside the container by itself. So it is an example of how cyber-physical, this interaction between the cyber components, communication, computation, and physical processes, which are the container terminal over here. So it is a nice example of cyber-physical systems. Another example can be found in pedestrian collision avoidance, where again we have all these sensors collect and estimate the environment around the car. And again, using computation technology, sensing and so on, we can, the computers inside the car starts to take actions, sometimes even overriding the human actions in order to avoid the collision. So if we look into the paradigm over time, computing started as isolated, where we have these computers are sitting by themselves. With the introduction of internet, we start having sharing resources, communication between different computation elements and so on. But what we are witnessing over this time is cyber-physical systems, where the computation have crossed the border. It is not sitting anymore inside our computers. It actually has crossed the border and control our physical environment, control things that evolve around us. And because of this interaction between the cyber and physical components, we have a multitude of challenges that we need to solve. So in this slide I got from Dr. David Corman, the NSF program manager, which shows the challenges that we need to address in order to come up with new CPS technologies. So you can see here that CPS is about systems of systems. How can we integrate safety criticality with IoT while taking care of privacy? How we can do real-time operations while taking care of security? How can we build all these things together? And once we have new technologies, how can we apply them to a multitude of different applications? And what is important about cyber-physical systems is they regulate some safety-critical applications, like think of autonomous drive, self-driving cars, think of medical robots, medical devices, and smart grid. These are all safety-critical applications, and this gives rise directly to the question of security. What can go wrong if someone hacks into the system and malfunction the system? So my PhD was funded by this DARPA project, the High Assurance project. And the video I'll show here is actually based on some of the work that have been done here at University of Washington on hacking cars.
This is a regular new car. The masking tape is only there because we agreed to obscure its make and model.
We'll give them the illusion they control the car for now.
Kaufman has been working on this for 5 years with multiple research teams.
You want to hit the fluids?
Oh my gosh.
There we go.
There we go.
What's that? That's the windshield wiper fluid. No, wait, so this is something that a hacker hit. That's right, a hacker. Like, obviously, you didn't turn on the windshield.
So this is one example of what can go wrong. Maybe windshields is not the most impressive example. So let's take this example.
So just stop at the cones here.
She thinks she's going to be able to stop right at those cones. Let's make sure that she can't, and she's going to drive right through them.
Right.
We'll have complete control of that brake.
All right, there we go.
Oh, no, 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 no.
The brakes didn't work, right?
Oh, my God. I can't operate the brakes at all. Oh, my word.
So this is one example of what can go wrong, okay? Because again, this interaction between computing and physical processes, this is not the only example that have been reported in the news. In this example here, it was reported that hackers were able to get live feed from the cameras inside police cars. Another example on the infamous Stuxnet virus, again, is the Iranian nuclear program. In this example, the US government admits that some foreign country were able to hack into the dam systems and malfunction the performance of this water management system. Many, many examples that are appearing these days. And because of that, NIST have this new report over here. It summarizes all these issues. It says that the logic execution, which is the cyber part, affects the physical world. And because of that, we have significant risk, serious financial issues, negative impact on nation's economy. And the question is, how can we deal with all these challenges? Motivated by these examples, my work on cyber-physical systems have focused on three particular problems, naming safety, security, privacy, and dependability. And across time, I was able to apply some of the ideas through my research in these three different applications: smart cities, IoT, automotive, and robotics. And these are the tools that I try to join together: convex optimization control systems from the EE domains, formal methods from CS, how we can integrate all these together in order to come up with solutions for these challenges. So just a research overview in terms of security. My first work was about how we can come up with new types of attacks that exist on CPS and does not exist on cybersecurity. Once we understand the attacks, how we can come up with countermeasures. So we have two different countermeasures. One we call a system-level countermeasure. This is more of another physical layer of sensing, while the other is system-level countermeasure. This will be the main part of my talk. On privacy, I worked on two different problems. The first one is on privacy-aware data processing. In a smart city, you have a lot of data that you would like to fuse together in a privacy-preserving fashion, how we can reason about the leaks, how we can do this at real time. The other problem is on mobile phone security. Mobile phones collect a lot of information that are very sensitive about our life, how we can reason about privacy of these collected data, especially location traces. And finally, on dependability, working on mission critical algorithms like pedestrian avoidance and motion planning from high level specifications. My outline for today's talk, I will start by arguing how we can attack cyber physical systems, then how we can defend against such an attacks, and finally, I will end up with some applications showing how these technologies behave in practice. So for the first part on CPS attack vectors, when I joined my PhD program, I got this question: what is different between cybersecurity and cyber physical system security? And my answer was trying to come up with a new attack vector that does not exist in cybersecurity. Before joining my PhD, I was working on the automotive industry. So I said, why not picking an automotive example? So in this example, this is the anti-lock braking system. This is the sensor using inside your ABS. Just go to your car, look behind the wheel, you will find these sensors very exposed. This sensor contains two parts: a permanent magnet, which is the wheel speed sensor on the top, and then we have the tone wheel, which rotates as your wheel is rotating. Because you have a tone wheel in front of a permanent magnet. In this gap, you'll have a magnetic field that is oscillating, and its frequency corresponds to the frequency of the wheel speed. This magnetic field signal goes to the sensor, which translates it to an electrical signal and gives it back to the ABS computer, which applies the brakes accordingly inside your car. And the question, how we can attack such sensor? So this is the module that we built over here. We call it ABS Hacker. And this module have, over here we have magnetic sensors and actuators. And we use these sensors to sense the magnetic field generated by this sensor. And then we use the actuator to inject one with an inverse sign, so they cancel each other, and then use the actuator to put another signal on top of it. By forming this problem as an optimal control problem, where the actual magnetic field is a disturbance that we would like to reject, and the spoofing signal is the set point that we would like to track, we built this module over here. We brought some pieces from a Mazda car. We built this test bed in this figure. And here is one result. So the red line on the top is the actual wheel speed from the normal ABS sensor if it is not under attack. The black line over here is the intention of the attacker. That's what the attacker would like the sensor to read, while the blue line is actually what the sensor under attack is reading. And from this figure, we can show that our module is doing a good job in terms of making the sensor exactly read what the attacker would like it to have, not the actual signal outside. The next step is to try this attack on a real car. So my advisor volunteered his car, but we couldn't find a grad student to ride a car with an ABS hacked on top of it. Filing IRB for this would be problematic. So we asked our collaborators at Toyota and Ford which type of simulators they use in order to test their algorithm. So they pointed us to this simulator called CarSim. And in this simulation over here, this is the first part of this video, is the normal behavior of an ABS system. Yeah, you will find some snow, you press the brakes, this is the normal behavior. Let's now have the same exact simulation, but having only one sensor being under attack, same driver, same control algorithms, but having only one of the sensors being under attack, once you push the brakes, that's what happened. In this particular scenario, we are attacking this wheel over here by making the ABS hacker report a very low speed. The ABS computer thinks that this wheel is not rotating, and he does not apply the brakes to this wheel while applying brakes to the other three wheels while this is actually rotating fast, and that's what happened. So this is not the only type of attacking sensors. Other people in literature have developed similar ideas. So in this work over here from University of Michigan, they showed how they can attack the pacemakers inside your body using a similar technique, using electromagnetic signals. They can malfunction the operation of the pacemakers. Another work on how you can use your speaker that generates acoustic signals to make the quad rotors drop down. The quad rotors have a MEMS gyroscope. They are very sensitive to acoustic signals. If you have a high watt speaker, just point it to the quad rotor, and that's what will happen. And what is interesting about these examples over here, that traditional cybersecurity offers no defense. These attacks happens on the physical domain, on the analog domain, even before the signal is transferred by the analog-digital converter and goes to the cyber domain. So cryptography, firewalls, all traditional cybersecurity techniques offers no defense in such attack. And this motivates the next question of how we can come up with countermeasures against such an attack. So, and the countermeasure that I will talk about over here that we call system-level countermeasure. So suppose you have a physical process like your car. You have a set of different sensors that are measuring different parts of your state. All these sensors are fused together. You try to estimate the state of the physical plant. Once you have a state estimate, you can give it to a feedback control algorithm, which will then control your physical process. And we ask the question, suppose that someone was able to hack into your car and is able to malfunction part of your sensors. He does not have access to all of the sensors. He has access to some of them. And now we ask the question, how we can, instead of doing state estimation, how we can do secure state estimation. How we can take all this information collected from all these various sensor modalities, fuse them in a secure fashion in order to estimate the physical state of the state of the physical plant, as well as knowing which sensors are under attack and which are not. So the threat model in this problem is as follows. We have P sensors. In this case, P may be equal to 20 sensors, and the attacker is able to hack to S of them. S can be three, for example. And we don't know which is which. We don't know which are under attack and which are attack-free. And in this context, whenever I'm talking about sensor attacks, it can be any type of attack. It can be using a non-invasive spoofing, like what I showed in the first part. It can be a virus. It can be some attack on the communication between the sensor and the controller. It can be anything. And once the attacker has access to S of these sensors, he can attack all of them at once. He can attack some of them, none of them. He can change his mind across time. We don't know what he will do a priori. And we have no assumptions about the structure of the attack. We don't have any stochastic models. We don't have boundedness models and so on. And the question, given these P, S out of P sensors, how we can estimate the state of the physical plant? In many system level countermeasures, what we rely on is redundancy. We need some redundant information in order to distinguish which of them is under attack and which of them are not. If all the sensors were homogeneous, if they are measuring the same exact physical phenomena, then majority voting works. If a number of sensors being under attack is strictly less than half of the sensors, then you can take majority voting over all of the sensors, and you will be able to distinguish which are under attack and which are not. However, in our case, our sensors are heterogeneous. They are not sensing the same physical part of the state. We can have a GPS and a current sensor that is measuring the current giving to the motor, for example. How we can reason about redundancy in a heterogeneity manner, as well as given that our systems are dynamics. And the key idea over here is to try to exploit physics. If I have a DC motor, I know that, and I have a sensor that is measuring the current, and I have a sensor that is measuring the speed, the rotation speed, I know the physical relation between current and angular speed. I can use this in order to sanitize which sensors are under attack and which are not. But the first question, how can we identify whether the amount of redundancy we have is enough or not? So let's assume for now that the physical plant evolve according to this linear dynamical model. So the state at time t plus one is related to the state at time t using this linear model. And here we have a P of sensors, so Y is a vector of length P. And the relation between the physical state and the outputs are covered by the C matrix. And then this A vector over here models what the attacker is doing. The attacker is able to hack into S of the sensors. So if we look into this vector, we'll find it is S sparse, meaning that only S components are non-zero, while the rest is equal to zero, but we don't know which is which. We know that the relation between the physical state and the outputs are captured by the observability matrix. So given this A and C matrices over here, we can compute this O matrix on the top. If this O matrix has full rank, then we call that this system is observable, meaning that the information coming from these sensors are enough to reconstruct or to estimate the state of the physical plant. Now, this is if we have no attacks. Now, how we can generalize this definition when we have attacks? So we define what we call an S-sparse observable system. If you can get rid of S of your sensors, and you can construct the observability matrix from the remaining, and the observability matrix is full rank, in this case, the information, even without using these S sensors, are enough to reconstruct the state. If you can do this for any combination of S sensors, this is called an S-sparse observable system. And a sufficient and necessary condition is your system have to be two S-sparse observable, meaning that if the attacker can attack three, you need to be able to get rid out to six of your sensors, and the remaining should be observable. And comparing this to the homogeneous case, this is a more generalized version where, again, you will see the 2S appears in the homogeneous case and the heterogeneous case. So again, we need a strict amount of redundancy, but now the observability matrix takes care of dynamics as well as the exploitation of physics. The same result, we have generalized it. Whenever we have nonlinear dynamics, whenever we have some Gaussian noise, bounded noise, and so on, but let's keep it simple for now. So this tells you the amount of information you need to be able to solve the problem. This is what we call the secure state estimation problem. It is not the only problem that we are interested in. A very similar problem is the secure localization problem, where you have a set of nodes, they are communicating together, and they are trying to measure the distance between each other, and from all these measurements, you are trying to localize the location of all these nodes. Again, assume that some of these nodes are malicious, S of them being under attack, how we can do this secure localization. Another related problem, which is secure traffic routing. In a smart city, you have hundreds of cars. They are reporting their own position, their own velocity, the velocity of the neighborhood cars. And from all this information, you'd like to estimate the congestion across the highway. Again, some of these nodes are malicious. They may even report the existence of cars that does not exist on the highway. That's what we call a civil attack. Again, how we can solve such a problem. So we'd like to have one solution that can go for all these problems, given the following constraints. First, scalability. These are IoT applications. We need solutions that can reason about hundreds or thousands of sensors, all of them together. And this has to happen at real time. We cannot freeze the highway until we collect all the information and do the processing. This has to happen at real time because of the physical plant is evolving over time. And unfortunately, all these problems are NP-hard. They are highly combinatorial in the number of sensors. So the technical question, how we can solve a highly combinatorial problem at real time and scales well? So this is one of our results. For secure state estimation, let's compare all the techniques reported in literature. Suppose we have 500 sensors and 100 of them being under attack, and the performance metric I will use is how the error in the state estimate. So the first approach, which is brute force search, you can enumerate all P minus S sensors and do some fault detection across all these different subsets and get the one that reports the correct one. So for this particular example, it timed out. It took more than 7 hours and was not able to enumerate all the subsets. But in a sense, it is optimal. If it finds the solution, it will find the best state estimate corresponding to these measurements. The other technique using mixed integer programming, again, this is took around 1.5 hours in this example and is suboptimal in general. Using some combinatorial search like Z3, again, it timed out after 3 hours. While our technique was less than 15 seconds without any relaxation and without any heuristics. And our technique is optimal whenever the attacker is, will hack the worst case set of sensors, which give you the most amount of information, and we can quantify how we can measure this. But it can be suboptimal in general. We add some worst case analysis in our algorithm. And the rest of my talk will be how we can go from this amount from 7 or 3 hours all the way to 15 seconds. And that's what we call satisfiability modulo convex optimization. So the main premise of this work is as follows. If I have only a cyber problem, okay, if I have digital circuit and this digital circuit is faulty and I'd like to analyze this circuit, then we can use SAT solvers in order to Boolean satisfiability solvers to reason about this, these problems. And it scales very well for large scale systems. If we have only a physical problem, which is just state estimation, reasoning about information collected from physical sensors, convex optimization is one of the main tools that we have been using for doing sensor fusion. And since we have a cyber-physical system, it suggests that we need to integrate these two tools together in order to come up with new tools that can reason about cyber-physical systems. In other words, if I plot the number of Boolean constraints versus the number of convex constraints, SAT solvers works very well whenever you have a lot of Boolean constraints. It does not reason about convex constraints. On the other one, convex optimization does not reason about Boolean constraints, it reasons about convex constraints, how we can merge them together. So let's start by having some motivation from the fault diagnostic in digital circuit. Suppose you this is your system and you have one of the sensors being malicious, okay, or faulty. You start by having Boolean indicator variables assigned to each one of these gates. Whenever this Boolean indicator variable is equal to zero, you think this gate is good. Whenever it is one, you think it is bad. You start having a model that relates the inputs and outputs of this system as a function of these health Boolean variables. Now you can start collecting inputs and outputs from your system. Everything here is just Boolean variables. You give it to a SAT solver, which will be able to reason about all this information together, giving assignments, zeros and ones, to which gates are malfunctioning and which are not. Let's do the same exercise, but for a cyber-physical system. Let's start again by having Boolean indicator variables. Zero means the sensor is good. One means the sensor is bad. Given our model, for now, let's assume it is a linear dynamical model. Again, we generalize it for nonlinear systems. But suppose I have a linear dynamical model. For the attack-free systems, for the attack-free sensors, we can build the relation between the state and the output is captured by the observability matrix for this sensor. And we have this term that captures the model mismatch. All our models are not that perfect, so there is always difference between reality and model. And we are interested in solving this problem. So we encode the secure state estimation using this formula over here. So we are looking for Boolean variables, B, and I will use this notation, red for Boolean variables, blue for real variables. So we are interested in searching over the domain of Boolean real variables such that whenever the ith Boolean variable is set to zero, then we think that this sensor is attack-free. The relation between the state that we are searching for and the outputs that are collected have to be at the discrepancy have to be at maximum this model mismatch coming from the equation above. And these have to happen for all the sensors from 1 to p that we think they are attack-free. And we know that at maximum, we have S of the sensors being under attack. If we can find assignments for B and X under the two S sparse observability condition, then we are able to find the state of the system and which sensors are under attack and which are not. This is a satisfiability problem. However, we cannot use normal Boolean SAT solvers because here we have some nonlinear constraints over the real part. So we started, so this is the encoding for the secure state estimation, which we can roll it forward and we'll have all these constraints over here. And instead of having this structure on the convex part and this structure on the Boolean part, we can generalize and put any convex constraints and any Boolean constraints. This is the grammar that captures all these constraints. We call it a satisfiability modulo convex formula. I don't want you to go through all the details, but you can see that this grammar supports all conjunctions and disjunctions of Boolean variables, all conjunctions and disjunctions of convex constraints. But if we look more into the structure that we have from our problem, we'll find all the convex constraints appear without a negation. So we can get rid of this part over here, and that's what we call a monotone SMC formula. Monotone SMC formula does not capture only the secure state estimation problem, but it actually captures all the security problems that we are interested in. For example, in the secure localization, again, we are looking for Boolean indicator variables saying which node is under attack and which are not, subject to this positive semi-definite condition over here. For secure traffic routing, it is exactly the same, but it is a little bit more involved. So if we can solve monotone, if we can find a solver that can solve for monotone SMC formulas, then we can find a solution for all these problems. Some nice properties about monotone SMC formulas. First, they are more general than mixed integer constraint programming. They include mixed integer programming, but they are strictly more general. The other property of monotone SMC formula that once you fix the Boolean part, once you come up with assignments for zeros and ones for the Boolean part, the rest of your problem is convex. And this suggests that in order to find satisfiable assignment, all what you need to do is to solve multiple convex optimization problems. So the complexity of finding a solution is the complexity to find a solution for the Boolean part of the problem plus the complexity to find a solution for the convex part of the problem multiplied by the number of iterations we need to go through this process. In our case, the time that is taking to find the Boolean part is relatively small, so it is not the main part of the complexity. We know solving convex optimization is polynomial up to a ball of epsilon. So the main complexity is then in the number of iterations, how many convex problems that we need to solve. And in order to reduce, if we can reduce this number of iterations, then we can come up with a good solver for such problems. And the key idea here is to use what's called a counterexample guided search, meaning whenever we solve a convex optimization problem, we'll try to extract as much information as we can from this problem in order to eliminate many other convex problems. So we solve one, we get rid of many of them, solve another one, get rid of many of them until we converge to the right one. So how to find such a satisfiable assignment? So we use a lazy SMT architecture. So we start by constructing the Boolean expansion of the formula. For each one of the convex constraints, we replace it with a Boolean indicator variable AI. And whenever this AI is satisfied, then this convex constraint is active. And because of the monotonicity, we need only one direction from the Boolean to the convex. We don't need the other direction because of the monotonicity. And it is easy to show that this Boolean expansion is equi-satisfiable to the original formula. If we can find a satisfying assignment for this one, we can project back and get a satisfying assignment here. If this one is unsatisfiable, this one is also unsatisfiable. So to find a solution, we start by taking the Boolean part of the problem, isolate it alone. Now it is completely Boolean, give it to a Boolean SAT solver. It will come up with an assignment for the Boolean variables B as well as the indicator variables AI. Once we know which constraints are active and which are not, now we can solve a convex optimization problem. If it is feasible, then we found a satisfying assignment for the Boolean part coming from the SAT solver, a real part coming from the convex optimization. If not, then we need to come up with an unsat certificate telling back the SAT solver, the assignment you give me to the B and A is incorrect, give me a better one. And then we iterate. The question, how can we make this iterative procedure works well in terms of performance? It is all about how we generate unsat certificates. To give you an example, if I have three convex constraints, this is all the search space about which constraints are active and which are not. If I give a counter, an unsat certificate that have this form, this is equivalent to getting rid of only one part in my search space. However, if I can do more and get this unsat certificate over here, this is equivalent to getting rid of this part of my search space. If I can do better, then I can remove half of the search space in one shot. So it is all about how we can get the shortest counter, the shortest unsat certificate. So to find the minimal unsat certificate of a convex problem, this is NP-hard in general. It is equivalent to finding the irreducible, infeasible set of a convex problem. However, in all our problems, we have more structure that we can use in order to reduce this, this complexity. As a summary of our results in this area, so that first row is the trivial counter unsat certificate, which we can always find. This is the minimal one, which is corresponding to the irreducible infeasible set. We were able to find three different unsat certificate. One of them is we can find it conoscent in time, and the other we can find it linear in time, reducing the complexity of the search space. Due to time constraints, let me just focus on one of them, which is the minimum prefix. Suppose you have a switched dynamical system or switched convex system. This appears in a lot of cyber physical systems where you have different modes for your system. At each mode, there is some convex constraints are active and some are not. If we try to find a solution assignment for which modes we are at and the state of the that satisfy all the convex constraints, the SAT solver will come up with one trace inside the Boolean part. We give it to the convex optimizer. He turns back and say, no, I cannot find a satisfiable assignment. So this is the trivial unsat certificate. However, if we can find the shortest unsat certificate in this case, which corresponds to this part over here, then this is corresponding to getting rid of all this part in our Boolean search space, and now we can iterate and converge very fast. So how can we do this? The one on the top is the original convex problem that we are interested in solving. And instead of solving this convex problem, we start adding slack variables to the convex problem, and we minimize over the summation of these slack variables. If we can make all of them equal to zero, then the original one is satisfiable. If not, then there is something wrong. And we start adding weights on these different slack variables such that we can come up with this guarantee, which says once you solve this convex problem, look into your slack variables, and the first one that corresponds to non-zero slack variable, it is exactly where the minimal unsat certificate occurs. And this happens by solving only one convex problem. To give you an example, this is the example I started with. If you solved, you'll find here that the slack variable, the first slack variable is equal to zero, and the rest will be not equal to zero, and this is guaranteed by the construction of the convex problem. And now this corresponds to the smallest unsat certificate. We can generalize for a higher class of problems that we call positively ordered unate. Let me skip this one and go directly to some scalability results. So in this example over here, we have around 5,000 Boolean variables. We scale the number of real variables, equal to 100, and we scale the number of convex Boolean constraints from 1,000 all the way to 130,000. And we plot against Cplex, one of the best commercial mixed integer programming tools, and as well as Z3, one of the best combinatorial search tools. We can see whenever the problem is small, then Cplex works better. However, as the complexity of the problem increases more, the Boolean complexity of the problem starts to increase more, we have better results compared to Cplex, and we can score up to three orders of magnitude better than Cplex. Let's do the other one, where here we increase the number of real variables instead. We'll see that Z3 in this case is very sensitive to the real constraints. It starts to scale very bad, and we can score up to four orders of magnitude compared to Z3. All these results are confirmed by the repeatability evaluation at the HECC. You can download the solver from this link over here and repeat all these experiments. Instead of giving more and more scalability results, let's go to the applications. So let's start with a secure state estimation. So in this experiment over here, our solver is running on board. Now we are applying some attacks. You can see the quadrotor is malfunctioning. And here at this point we'll increase the attack vector, and that's what will happen. Let's have the same exact trajectory, but with our solver running on board. You see that it is running very smooth until it comes to this point. And at this point, we'll generate the high magnitude attack vector. You see it flickered a little bit, and it was able to detect the attack and then go back to safety. Let me skip over these results and go back directly to the secure traffic routing. In this case, we have a highway. We have some malicious cars. It starts reporting its own velocity and position, but starts reporting some fictitious cars that does not exist. So it says there is a car behind me with this velocity, and it says there is another one in front of me, and it can start adding more and more and more until the traffic router thinks that the highway have a lot of cars and is congested, and because of that, it will start routing the cars inside the city, and it can start doing actual congestions inside the city. So this is one example of a Sybil attack, putting more nodes that does not exist inside the system. So in these experiments, we collected real information from Bologna city. We feed them to a simulator that simulates the actual traffic configuration inside the city. And then we start injecting more cars, malicious cars, on top of this traffic and report and give it to the traffic router, once without any protection, and in the other case, while our algorithm is running. Again, this is high-scale amount of information, embracing all the information coming from the city. The top figure is when without any security. You can see that the average travel time can go all the way to 60 minutes, while here with our algorithm, we can push it all the way back to 20 minutes. So to summarize, I started by motivating that CPS security is different than cybersecurity. We have some attacks that does not exist in cybersecurity, and I give the ABS example. In order to reason about CBS, we need new tools that can reason about two different domains, Boolean and real variables, and it scales well. And finally, these algorithms work well in practice. So in the remaining 10 minutes, I would like to share with you some of the future directions that I'm interested in. Today, I talked mainly about security, but in general, I'm interested about resilient cyber physical systems, how we can design resiliency in its general terms. So the first direction is this combination between logical reasoning and convex optimization. I showed monotone SMC formulas as one example of this integration between logical reasoning and convex optimization. There are many others, but one of the main problems that I'm interested in is going from feasibility to optimality. So far in monotone SMC formulas, it was all about finding satisfiable assignments. However, to design a CPS, we need to design the optimal, we need to search for the optimal design, how we can take, again, this combination of logic and convex optimization, find optimal assignments. The other direction is on the structure of the solver itself. I talked about counterexample guided search. We can go to the more general class of an oracle guided search, where we have an oracle that can give us positive examples, implication examples, not only counterexamples. The other direction, I'm recently collaborating with Northrop Grumman, and we showed them some results on using our technique for motion planning and security inside the satellites. And they were interested in taking this technology, put it on a real satellite. And they said, we need to do better computation at runtime, how we can do parallel, parallel computing. They coined this term SMC on chip, how we can use ideas from software, hardware co-design in order to come up with the perfect solver that can run on their satellites. Once we have this framework that we can reason about logic and convex optimization, we can apply it to multiple applications, especially I'm very interested in self-driving cars. I will list here three applications, but there are many others. One of them is formal verification of CPS. Formal verification is having a lot of attention inside the control community right now, and there is formal verification community, the normal computer science formal verification community. However, the tools that are used here and there seems to be very diverse from each other, and I believe that having a combination of logic reasoning and convex optimization, we can bring the ideas from these two communities together, how we can reason about the real code that is running inside our cars while taking into account the physical constraints. The other direction is on certification of deep learning networks. So this is motivated by the accident of from Tesla car. We have a neural network that is trying to do some machine or pattern recognition. And because it was not certified, we know all the accident that happened in Tesla car. And I can show for a class of neural networks, certifying deep learning networks is equivalent to finding a solution for a monotone SMC formula. Again, we can divide the structure of the neural network using the Boolean variables and reason about the weights and so on using the convex optimization. The third direction is about taking this idea of security, putting on a real car. Again, this is motivated by the work with Northrop Grumman, where they would like to put it on some quadrotors and satellites. The other direction is in terms of privacy. So especially in smart cities, how can we come up with privacy-aware IoT services, localization, model predictive control in a privacy-aware fashion? To reason about sensor fusion in smart cities, usually we use convex optimization. To reason about privacy, we can use cryptography, how we can blend these two together. And recently, we have been collaborating with Intel and coming up with some ideas of using homomorphic encryption, garbled circuits from the secure function evaluation community, put it with convex optimization, we showed that the amount of leakage that can happen because of this integration is equivalent to analyzing the KKT conditions of the convex optimization. We built some systems around it. We will have a real-time demo in the next CPS week showing how we can do localization in a privacy-aware fashion. Finally, the last direction is on smart cities, especially socially aware smart cities. So this some recent collaboration with CMU, where we are trying to reason about the homelessness problems inside cities, how we can use cyber-physical system technology to sense and predict how homeless people are changing over time. We are taking some data from an organization in downtown San Diego, where they go and collect information about all the homeless people inside San Diego. We build some models. We use them to predict. We are trying to build right now some information system that can optimize the resource sharing inside the city. So this is another direction that I'm very interested in. And I just got my first NSF award on this direction. Let me stop here by acknowledging and thanking all my collaborators, my PhD advisors, my postdoc advisors, I have many of them, all the students and PhD and postdocs that I collaborated with, Dr. David Corman from NSF for his tremendous help in getting the NSF grant regardless many administration issues, as well as our collaborators from industry. And finally, I thank you for you all for attending my talk, and I would be happy to take any questions.
Okay, we have time for some questions. Any questions? Yes,
please.
Payman.
Can you talk about the power system application that you quickly skipped over?
Sure.
So in this example, we are trying to test our algorithm against scalability. We would like to see how much it scales. So we started with a model, the IEEE 14 bus model. It has five generators, some nodes. We do some cron reduction in order to get differential equation that is governing the synchronization between these generators. Each generator has two sensors, one for the angular speed, one for the phase angle. And we use this model and start to increase it as if we have small communities, and we start to increase it more and more and more. And we pick some of these sensors, attack them, and we would like to estimate the physical state of the system, which is the physical angle as well as the rotation speed. So this is the example that I just showed in the very first part of the talk. This is how the algorithms scale. Moreover, we can do even better by having recursive estimation. And instead of collecting information over a window, and we try to use this to perform estimation, if we can do recursion, by as we have more and more information, we update our estimate and we make it converge as we have more and more information, actually we can get one order of magnitude reduction in terms of performance, in terms of execution time, as well as one order of magnitude in terms of the state estimation error. Recursive estimators are more robust to noise and disturbances as they collect more and more information. So this is the example that I just go through.
More questions?
Please.
Yes, Chris.
So the example of the drone was pretty interesting. You could see that the processor on the drone was able to operate the drone and then also run this, I guess I would call it background optimization to look for an attack. What I was actually wondering for a lot of this other stuff, including the example of a car, you know, how much of the processor power does this take in order to run these real-time background optimizations all the time? I would think that's a big component or sort of a figure of merit of evaluating these things, because you usually have an engine control module that's got to do a lot of other functions inside the, just to operate the vehicle, sure, and run the right timing on the engine. Do people in this community, do they speak of these type of algorithms in terms of So, amount of processor power that's taken, percentage of the processor.
So one figure of merit is the execution time needed to perform such a...
But is that at 100% processor power? Or?
So in cars, you have very powerful processors. Like, as I told you, before being in the PhD, I was working in the automotive embedded systems. And usually, one of the architectures that are used in cars is called the FEMREM architecture, where you have two very powerful processors, the front and the rear. Okay, and these are laptop scale processors. So the same algorithm that runs over here will have the same execution time that's running over there. Usually when we design these systems, they make the maximum execution time does not go over 30% of the processor capabilities for safety issues. So I believe it, for especially for cars, since we have really powerful processors, it may not be problematic. For other IoT services, like I'm not sure about satellites, how powerful the processors are on satellites. This is a question that we have for our colleagues at Northrop Grumman. But as far as I understand, it is not that powerful. And replacing these processors takes a lot of money and testing to come up with new technologies that are certified against these harsh conditions. So I believe in cars, it may not be a problem. But for other applications, of course, it is something to consider.
Other questions? More? No, okay, thank you. Thank you, Yasser.
Thank you very much.